Next, I call upon Dr. Ritesh R. Nair, who is not new to our IMA. He has done a couple of presentations before. Without wasting much time on his CV, his area of interest is an acute stroke treatment, including mechanical thrombectomy, aneurysm coiling, flow divert replacement for giant aneurysms, carotid and intracranial stenting, AVM embolization, dural fistula embolization, tumor embolization, transient of refractory epistaxis, spinal angiogram, and spinal AVM fistula embolization. I once again request all the speakers to stick to their timings, please. I request Dr. Ritesh.
Along the wire, we take a guiding catheter, we mark the guiding at either in the tree where there is a pathology, so this is the right common carotid. And very generally we take a microcatheter, this is the aneurysm we can see, which is pulsating. So microcatheter is generally placed in the sac of the aneurysm and we start coiling. So once the coil is come back, it starts thrombosing and finally over time, next 2 to 3 hours it will get totally thrombosed. This is the technology we use, this is the usual way, this is a very minimally invasive way of treatment, but sometimes we have limitations. Sometimes we get an aneurysm with a wide neck. So then again we have some advancement. We place the microcatheter gently. Then we place it. Then if we put the coil gets collapsed into the parent vessel and can cause thrombosis. So here what we do is we place a small balloon across the neck of the aneurysm, inflate the balloon and then start coiling. So the coil must form a frame which suddenly, it's over time, over next 2 to 3 minutes form a thrombus, so it will stay inside the aneurysmal sac. And again, if we have a very broad neck aneurysm with a wide outpouring and the disease wall around the aneurysmal neck, then again we have very compliant balloons which take the morphology of the wall of the or the lumen of the artery and air coiling the same way. So advantages of endovascular coiling, we can access multiple points at the same time. If there are multiple aneurysms, some cases I will show, you can do the coiling in the same sitting. Also in some cases we have very raised ICP due to the massive subarachnoid hemorrhage, then the surgeon has a little hesitation opening the brain. Because of the raised ICP, the brain may bulge and there may be a high chance of reabsorption when we open sudden release or pressure. So in those situations also endovascular coiling has the advantage. But the disadvantage is it is very expensive and over the last few years it is getting favorable and we have more number of operators also now. So one example, this is a 77-year-old gentleman who came with a subarachnoid hemorrhage. Grade was 15 by 15. Good. This is the aneurysm. You can see an anterior communicating artery aneurysm pointing interiorly. This is the lateral view. You can see interiorly, posteriorly pointing aneurysm. So this is how the microcatheter slowly entering in the aneurysm over the guide wire, over the micro wire. This is the lateral view, same thing. So these are very malleable, very trackable microcatheters which can, and this is how we generally coil the aneurysm. So this is the first coil, it takes the shape of the aneurysm, so the framing coils, and we continue packing it with multiple coils, platinum coils, and over time it will thrombose and the aneurysm will be free. This is the coil mask. Similar case, 165-year-old lady with the aneurysm, very dangerous aneurysm in the proximal base guard at the vertebral vessel junction, diffuse subarachnoid hemorrhage. So you can see a relatively broad based aneurysm, broad neck aneurysm. This is the vertebral artery, you can see the tortuous anatomy and very dispersing arteries. Here we used a small balloon across the aneurysm. This is the balloon and this is the microcatheter and we coiled aneurysm. So another gentleman with a subarachnoid hemorrhage around 10 days back, TCS from TCS. He has a middle cerebral artery aneurysm pointing laterally and inferiorly. This is a subarachnoid hemorrhage. This is a CT angio showing the aneurysm. This is a DSA showing the aneurysm. It is a very relatively narrow neck. So we don't have to use a balloon in this scenario. So we put multiple coils and we can see this is a control angio at the end of the procedure. So this is another chronic smoker, 58 years, he had history of intermittent hospital headaches for 6 months. Hypertensive on irregular treatment, MRI was done outside shoulder, superior cerebellar artery aneurysm, with no evidence of subarachnoid hemorrhage. So this is the aneurysm shown in the superior cerebellar artery, this is the basilar artery. So incidentally, because of his atherosclerotic risk factors, he has a very unfolded aorta, very unfriendly arch, we have a stenosis in the proximal subclavian on the right side, as well as the vertebral artery, we have to enter through the stenosis. So in these scenarios, we have to be difficult, so sometimes we use the radial approach to the aneurysm. Also on the left side, you can see the subarachnoid artery, and subclavian artery, there is a proximal vertebral artery stenosis. and this is the aneurysm in the superior cerebral artery level. Also, he has an incidental aneurysm in the MCA bifurcation also. So, considering multiple pathologies, this is the one which needs urgent treatment. So, the only way to enter the aneurysm is to go through the right radial approach, what the cardiologist followed. Exactly, we did the same thing. We can enter the right vertebral artery through the radial puncture. We can take the guiding into the vertebral artery from the brachial artery. This is the guiding part in the right vertebral. And here also we used a balloon assisted coiling. This is a very compliant balloon. It should take the morphology of the artery and allow us coiling. This is multiple coils, multiple settings. You can see the balloon takes the shape of the space available after each coil. So this is final coil mass. Patient is on follow-up, he is on dual antiplatelets, but incidentally during the same procedure we noticed there was a slow flow in the left vertebral artery because there was a tight stenosis, around 70% stenosis of the proximal vertebral artery. So we discussed with the family that in the same setting we can also treat this with that. Definitely he is going for a slow flow end of the procedure, we can see thrombus forming. So discussed with the family, they agreed for a standing, so same sitting we did a balloon mounted standing. Now we have 1 year follow-up, patient is fine on double antiplatelets. So in some scenarios we have patients present with subarachnoid hemorrhage and have multiple intracranial aneurysms of the same setting. This is a 61-year-old lady with similar story. She presented with a subarachnoid hemorrhage on the left ciliary fissure. This is the left ciliary fissure bleed. And this is CT angio showing an anterior dorsal wall aneurysm. So here is the left intracarotid artery angio lateral view. You can see this is a larger aneurysm, there is a proximal smaller aneurysm also. So we know the pathology which is the culprit is the larger aneurysm which has spread on the left side. So at the first sitting we did the coiling of this aneurysm. And we told the family that she will need treatment for both aneurysms. This is after 1 month of the coiling, we did a check angio, which is well healed. So we did the follow-up, this is a 3D rotational angio reconstructed. So we can see this is the coil mass which has totally healed and endothelialized in 1 month, and we can see the proximal aneurysm which is very irregular and the whole artery is diseased. Incidentally, she has right also she had two outpouchings in the same corresponding area, the paraophthalmic segment, this is the ophthalmic artery, one pointing superiorly and one inferiorly. So she had total 4 aneurysms, only one we have treated now. So this location, the paraophthalmic segment is known for multiple aneurysms. So in view of this, we told the family she has already incidence of rupture, so whether wait and watch or consider treatment because it is an intracranial segment location, so it can cause a subarachnoid hemorrhage. Family agreed for the treatment. So in this scenario, we have now a new hardware or a stent which is a closely braided stent which can take the form of the, it's like a stent graft, takes the form of the artery, and over time it will divert the flow from entering in the aneurysm, and over time the aneurysm will get thrombosed. It's called flow diverters. This is the vasodynamics, what happens after the stent flow diverter placement. The flow into the aneurysm will be slowly reduced, and over time in 3 to 6 years it can heal. So same thing was offered for bilateral ICS ending or flow diverter placement. This is the already coiled aneurysm, this is the proximal one. So here we can see the stent mesh. It is like a braided thing, you can see a helical thing on the left side. This is the left stent, on the right side also we did the stenting, and you can see immediately within the during the procedure itself there is a stasis of, that is stagnation of the blood inside the aneurysm. That means it is going for thrombosis. This is the intraop picture. You can see the stent braids. So after 6 months we did a control angio. You can see this was the aneurysm, the first coiled aneurysm and the proximal aneurysm. 6 months you can see the docking has disappeared. On the right side also, these are the two aneurysms on the paraophthalmic segment. 6 months, 3 months later, you can see it has totally reformed. The artery has reformed. So this is a new modality of treatment. One other case I'll show, this is a 50-year-old gentleman. He had a large aneurysm on the vertebral vessel junction. Here also we put a co-diverter. This is a co-diverter stent in the vertebral vessel artery. This is another lady with an incident aneurysm in paraophthalmic. Here also we did the flow diversion. These are the newer modality of treatment available for intracranial aneurysms. So sometimes there are some abnormal communication. I told atrial venous malformation where the nidus ruptures and causes bleed. It's a young boy in the hospital hemorrhage. He had a bad ABM, large ABM in the hospital trigone. we did multiple stages of treatment. Here also we take a small microcatheter into the nidus and inject an embolizing agent called Onyx. Over time, like 45 minutes to 1 hour, we can totally cure the aneurysm. You can see this are the pre and this are post. He's doing well. He will continue to be on antiepileptics. The other pathology is called direct communication in the dual levy fistula. There is abnormal communication in the dural covering of the brain. Here the venous return is impaired due to the reversal of the flow. This is a 56-year-old postman who had progressive intellectual decline. He can't do the calculation in the office. He had multiple dural arteries. There is a pathology. There is calcification already setting in. It's a sign of long-standing venous hypertension. This is the dural vessel you can see. He has multiple entry points. External carotid artery is supplying the dural sinuses. So the flow is reversed in the reverse direction, so the brain doesn't have an outline to have an outline. So it's a functional stenosis or functional obstruction of the venous outlet. This is the dual, abnormal dural blood. Here also we have to reach with the microcatheter into the mouth of the fistula and inject the glue-like embolization agent. This is a long process. Here we took around 3 to 4 hours to complete that. And this is the final cast. And you can see the total reversal of the flow. Now 1 year, he is totally cognitively better. There was one episode of seizure, but he is well controlled with antiepileptics. So this is a post-traumatic carotid fistula, where we did the coiling. So rarely, we may come across spinal malformation also, the tumors. Here the patient is a 61-year-old gentleman who presented with progressive paraparesis. We can see the vascular flow voids in the posterior fecal sac. Here, during a spinal angiogram, we can localize the fistula and we can directly go in and embolize this. This is the fistula's point where the radicular artery is merging with the radicular vein and causing spinal dural fistula. This is one case of hypervascular tumor where we could do an embolization so that surgeon can easily operate. This is a very hypervascular tumor, glomus tubularis. We did an embolization and it was taken for surgery by the neurosurgeon. So they can easily operate and mask. So lack of time, I'll just keep. This is one only case I'll show. He's a 74-year-old retired IIT professor, mathematics professor. He came in the middle of the morning, about 7 o'clock. He suddenly collapsed. He had a left MC occlusion. This is the MC occlusion. You can see he came with the right hemiparesis with the global aphasia. So it was in the fourth hour. They reached around 10 o'clock. We gave IV thrombolysis and told them in the large vessel occlusion we can do intervention and open the artery there. So here we take a small guiding catheter. Inside that we take a inner catheter and reach the spot. This is the micro catheter at the thrombus and we aspirate over 4 to 5 minutes. You can totally aspirate the thrombus and then recanalize. So definitely technology is advancing and we have more tools and more hardware which can minimal invasive we can reach the several vascular pathologies and deal. So definitely the time will tell whether several vascular pathology will slowly evolve into endovascular. But definitely there is always a role for conventional treatment. Because definitely if you look at only in the way we do, it looks like a plumbing service. We seal the leak and open the blockage. But it has to be clinical as well as the patient-oriented approach. So definitely hybrid technology will stay at the best of time. Thank you. Thank you.
Any questions?
Should we continue with antiepileptics after the surgery?
Yes, sir.
How long?
1 to 2 years to continue.
I request Dr. Anderson to hand over, please, sir.